full debate if the Cowboys should trade Romo. We have a special premiere of a new DJ Steve Porter mashup. Please don't miss that. But up first, a very serious subject. Seattle area police released letters, emails, and a journal in which Giants kicker Josh Brown admitted to domestic violence. The documents were part of an investigation stemming from Brown's arrest in May of 2015 following an incident with his wife. Now, these are quotes by Josh Brown from released documents. I have physically, mentally, emotionally, and verbally been a repulsive man. I have abused my wife. I have controlled her by making her feel less human than me and manipulated her with money. I viewed myself as God, basically, and she was my slave. Here's Giants owner John Mara speaking on WFAN yesterday afternoon on this subject.
And we were obviously disturbed by it, but based on what we knew, and particularly based on this young man's attempt to try to rehabilitate himself, which I still believe he is trying to do, and he's made a good faith effort to do that as far as I know, we were comfortable with the decision to continue to employ him. I can't answer right now what the future holds for him. I think we need to gather some more information and then try to make as intelligent a decision as we can. He's admitted to us that you know, he's abused his wife in the past, and you know, I think what's a little unclear is the extent of that.
So Brown will not travel to London with the team for Sunday's game as originally reported against the Rams. The Giants said in a statement they will revisit the issue when they return. Earlier Thursday, the NFL said it would review the case and determine next steps in the context of the NFL personal conduct policy. With that, Stephen A., what culpability do the Giants and the NFL have here?
Extreme culpability. The only thing that we can say in favor of them is not as extreme as Josh Brown, because he's the ultimate villain in all of this. He's admitted to physically, mentally, emotionally abusing a woman that he took a vow to spend the rest of his life with. I mean, how much worse can it get than that? And clearly he was a repeat violator in that regard, which is why they ended up in the divorce. So there's nothing to debate there. As it pertains to the New York Giants and the NFL, as far as I'm concerned, there's nothing to debate here either. If you are the New York Giants, somehow, some way, first of all, before I even say that there's no excuse for how they act, let me make sure that I qualify my comments by saying this, because it's very, very important to say. No matter who you are, no matter what position you hold, this kind of behavior can't be excused. It can't be condoned. It has to be condemned at every level, and that's the bottom line. But forgive me if it also resonates in my mind how all of these clear exceptions or clear modifications or leniency, rather, is being accorded to a 37-year-old kicker. Are you kidding me? It makes absolutely no sense whatsoever. We might not like it. We might not approve of it. But if it was a superstar player or what have you, is inexcusable as it would be, at least we could make rhyme or reason as to why it's taking place, no matter how egregious it may be. But in the case of Josh Brown, I'm at a loss for why the concessions have been made for this man. He should have been off the team as far as I'm concerned. If you're the New York Giants, who's supposed to be an organization that's class personified, who's supposed to be about doing everything on the up and up, the Maras and the Tishas and all of them, and a reputation that they have built spanning decades, to sit here and allow this particular individual over the last year to essentially stain this franchise makes absolutely no sense whatsoever. They should be condemned themselves. They should be called to the carpet. I can't believe the man went on radio in New York City and actually acknowledged that he was aware of a past involving domestic violence with Josh Brown. Don't tell me you weren't aware of this stuff when in fact you've acknowledged that you were aware to some degree of it. So there was no reason for the man to be suspended for just one game. It should have been more severe. And on behalf of the NFL, how in God's name do you come off of Ray Rice? Do you come off of Greg Hardy? Go to Josh Brown and think that one game is going to suffice. And then to sit up there and to tell us that a multi-billion dollar establishment, okay, generating in excess of $18 billion plus a year, number one sport in America, with goobs and gobs of money, which means influence, can't get their hands on information.
Thank you. Finding out
exactly what this dude, Josh Brown, exactly has done. And then not only that, there's a divorce file, Max and Molly, that was out there. Josh Brown told us months ago He was getting divorced from his wife. He told the media that. So you could have looked up the divorce papers. And then I'm going to go here, Max. Listen, I don't know Josh Brown from a can of paint. Nobody's excusing Ray Rice. We damn sure ain't excusing Greg Hardy. These are two individuals who committed egregious acts and needed to pay for them. Ray Rice has shown an incredible level of contrition compared to Greg Hardy, which is why a lot of us promote the idea of him getting a second chance. But the acts were committed. They deserved to be punished. Everybody acknowledges that with the brothers. But this white dude, Josh Brown, who is a kicker on the New York Giants, who had literally taken a journal highlighting his transgressions, his egregious acts. And it's not until a couple of days ago when the Kings County office in Washington sits up there and releases this information that suddenly here we are again. This should have been handled by the New York Giants. It should have been handled by the NFL. It was egregious that they haven't handled this. It's egregious that they still haven't handled this. It's not enough for him not to be going to London. He should be suspended immediately for the max that is allowed under the collective bargaining agreement because of what Ray Rice has suffered, because of what Greg Hardy has suffered from. In the interest of fairness, this has to be handled. And the Giants and the NFL need to be called to the carpet for this. This is a damn shame.
I want to address the Ray Rice and Greg Hardy stuff in a minute. But I just first want to say that I believe today, everyone and yesterday, everyone is asking the same questions. Yeah. It's baffling. The reaction of the NFL and the Giants is baffling. I want to start actually with the NFL. And everyone's going to say this too, and you said it today, Stephen A. On the heels of Ray Rice, what happened to a zero tolerance policy? It seems the opposite of that. And everyone's going to ask the same question. And for a 37-year-old kicker, and the reason people bring that up, it's not to say, well, if he was a star, it would be okay. It's to say, to on the one hand say you're focusing on this issue of domestic violence, which is, along with race and police brutality, particularly as it pertains to race, the two social issues of the day. It's one of the two major social issues of the day. And in the NFL, there was the issue of the anthem and the protests, but even simultaneous with that is the issue of domestic violence in the NFL, Greg Hardy and others. So it's baffling. People have, and I have questions about it. Why? It seems like such an easy thing to do. Zero tolerance, here's the suspension, as opposed to going light for this guy. And from the Giants' point of view, it's not their greatest, most shining moment. It also seems baffling. As a 37-year-old kicker, that is a proud family-owned organization. You never hear former players bad-mouthing them. They're considered to be run very well. I consider them to be a well-run organization that has higher principles even that they adhere to. Plexico Burris, they don't like what happens with him from a legal point of view. They will step in and say, no, he's not playing for us before even the league. You know, they do things in a way you would think they'd be the first ones to say, no, you can't do that. So I've been asking these questions. What happened to zero tolerance policy? And here's what I came up with at first. And then I got past even this. At first I thought, well, maybe they saw the journals and the journal entries that Josh Brown made, and they read them as confessional, the way one would confess to a priest in private or to a shrink in therapy, and thought, well, look, here is a guy who is working on himself, who's owning up to his mistakes, and who's trying to be better. The problem is both the NFL, whether or not that passes muster in the first place, I'm going to get to that in a second, both the NFL and the Giants have said they didn't see the journal. So it couldn't have been that. Well, at least he's working on himself, and anyway, this should have been private and all that. It couldn't have been that if they didn't see it. So I'm left with the idea. Malcolm Gladwell wrote about this in Blink, that you know what's most highly correlated with lawsuits for malpractice with doctors? It's not actually their results. It's their bedside manner. Bedside manner. You could have bad results and good bedside manner and be sued less for malpractice than good results with a bad... Wait, I'm not done. Good results with a bad bedside manner. And I think that's how it applies to Josh Brown. I think that he, and you hear his teammates and everyone talking about him, they see him as a good guy. And they're not looking at the recidivism, the fact that the behavior was a pattern and continuing. But they see him as a good guy, and that bedside manner allowed a 37-year-old kicker to skate with these very serious charges and even confessions that he's made about domestic violence. By the way, the worst among the worst of them was the fact that he admitted to being physical with his ex-wife when she was between 4 and 6 months pregnant.
Sickening.
Well, here's the deal. The other part about it, and listen, when we bring up the dichotomy that exists between a Ray Rice and a Greg Hardy and how they were treated and a Josh Brown and how he's being treated, here's why I also brought up you got two brothers that have been raked through the coals, deservedly so, no doubt, but nevertheless raked through the coals, and Josh Brown has been protected. It's not about, you're not looking and walking around and seeing a white person here, a white person here, and thinking something like that. No, you're talking systemically. It harkens you back to the days with issues with black coaches and beyond, and the great Bill Walsh talking about how, you know, folks don't necessarily ingratiate themselves with us well enough, or vice versa, et cetera, et cetera. You're talking about relationships. And the fact of the matter is, some folks have better relationships than others. There is no doubt that Josh Brown clearly has a good relationship with Giants ownership. What other justification can there be? Even if you have relationships with players and they love you and they're your teammates, Steve Weatherford is a good guy. He's been on this show on many occasions. He's one of Josh Brown's best friends, former teammate, spoke up for him just the other day. He's entitled to do that. What I'm saying is he ain't the decision maker. Those teammates of his ain't the decision makers. The coach is, the GM is, ownership is. And don't tell me that Jerry Reese or Ben McAdoo went to ownership on behalf of Josh Brown and say, it's imperative that we keep this 37-year-old kicker. Oh, hell no.
In my opinion,
Mara going on New York radio and speaking about this speaks to his direct involvement with Josh Brown from a relationship perspective. And when you have that going on, that's where the dichotomy exists. That's where the problem takes place, because every player ain't fortunate enough to have those relationships. So if relationships are going to dictate ramifications, then there's going to always be folks on the losing end, and fairness is never going to be a part of the equation. And that is clearly not the case with Josh Brown, who should have his behind suspended now. I said it months ago when this stuff was revealed. He should have been suspended, and one game certainly wasn't enough. It's ridiculous.
I don't ever dismiss claims or at least thoughts about how race has an impact on these things, because clearly, given our history, of the history of this country, That is a reasonable question to ask, and it's likely that race often does play a factor. It's unknowable maybe how much of a factor. Certainly relationships play a factor, and maybe race plays into relationships. Although in Ray Rice's case, much like Josh Brown, who leads the prayer group and everything, Ray Rice was considered a good guy with good relationships.
Yes, he was.
The difference in the Ray Rice case was
video.
The difference in the Greg Hardy case was lack of responsibility, the appearance that he wasn't taking responsibility for his behavior, owning up to it, and really looking to make changes or even really acknowledging it. The Josh Brown, there's no video. There is a journal, but there's a difference. And
right,
there's a sense that he's owning his behavior, although I agree the behavior continues. So it doesn't really matter much what he says. It's what he does.
Let me tell you why, even though Ray Rice had the video and Greg Hardy showed a minimal, if any, contrition at all, why this is so important, Max, why it doesn't matter. You know why it doesn't matter? Because that's the backdrop. Now, if Josh Brown happened beforehand, that's fine. But the fact that Ray Rice happened, the fact that Greg Hardy happened, the fact that the NFL was raked through the coals and had their reputation smeared because, you know, the lack of due diligence they were accused of putting forth in Roger Goodell, all of a sudden we got articles in USA Today and Beyond highlighting 50 different cases where Roger Goodell may have been able to be more active than he had actually been. The fact that the NFL had to implement policies, the fact that the NFL had to hire individuals that specialized in situations like this, all female, by the way. The fact that the NFL went through all of these things to address this specific issue, and then to turn around after all of that and still let a 37-year-old kicker off the hook. A 37-year-old kicker.
Well,
am I wrong here?
I want Max to jump back in because I was writing down a couple questions as you guys were talking, and these are a few that I have. One, during all this, why did they re-sign the man? That's my first question. During this, they re-signed him to contract extension. What are you doing? Second question here, where are the four women that were named to help the NFL in terms of the domestic violence policy? I want to hear from them because it appears that they botched this. And I could be wrong, and I'd love for them to speak out and explain it to me. Just two more things. Another thing, as far as the bedside manner you spoke to, Anita Marks talked about that with Michelle and Marcellus on Sports Nation yesterday. She covers the team, and she said it was exactly that. He was a great guy around the organization, so people didn't expect this kind of behavior and maybe didn't do their due diligence. And my last thing, Stephen A., to what you brought up, so there's these documents. Why can the NFL and the Giants not obtain these documents? So then I'm told they're in divorce papers. Please, yeah, I want you to. So they're in his divorce file. Did you ever think the man might have got divorced partially because of the fact related to these domestic violence issues? So there might be information there. And one last thing that I want to say, Ben McAdoo had said, we're not going to turn our back on him. And, you know, we're going to stick by Josh Brown. Great, but you turned your back on his family. And if you want this man, if you truly love this man, he needs to get healthy. He's sick. He can't worry about football. He needs to put 100% into these demons and deal with them.
In terms of the why did they extend the contract, this is one of the worst components of domestic violence because the family is an economic unit, is part of a pull that keeps women in relationships that are bad for them. And so part of the issue, well, if he doesn't work, then how does he provide for his family, including his children, which are also his wife's children? That's part of the serious and tragic nature of domestic violence, I think. Stephen A.?
Well, listen, you're right, Max. Absolutely. But that's why the NFL and the Giants can't be excused. Because they knew all of this. One of the things, if you recall, with the whole Ray Rice scandal, one of the things that resonated was the fact that his then fiance, now wife, went before Roger Goodell and pled on behalf of her husband. Roger Goodell used that as justification for giving him the initial 2-game suspension because he had not seen the video from the situation in Atlantic City. So while Roger Goodell hired those four ladies in the NFL league office to assist in addressing these matters was not just from an investigative perspective, but also from the perspective of the alleged victim, what has transpired, how do we deal with this? Because he was acknowledging as a league office, possibly even as a human being, that he was ill-equipped to deal with this himself. So with all of that as a backdrop and all the things that the NFL, the Shield, not to mention the individual teams under its purview and 1,000+ players under its purview that everybody had to be subjected to over the last year and a half or so because of Ray Rice and the Greg Hardy situation, a 37-year-old kicker named Josh Brown gets dealt with lightheartedly. It is as egregious as it gets. It speaks to, if not nepotism, favoritism, because it is clear that most other people would not get treated the way that Josh Brown has gotten treated, which leads us to ask the question, because we don't know. It leads us to ask the question, why? Why did this dude get that kind of leniency? Not just from the Giants, Because even though it's inexcusable, we can understand it because clearly ownership likes him, if not loves him. But the NFL, why not? Why
not? I think, Molly, your question is the best one as it relates to this information. Because the issue in the Ray Rice case that came up as the facts were coming out was there didn't seem to be a good faith effort by the NFL to acquire the videotape. Mm-hmm. The video was available, and it didn't seem like they tried very hard to get it. And here it comes out that the NFL called the sheriff's department to get the journal, but they didn't identify themselves as the NFL. And once they were told no, they didn't try again, according to the sheriff's department. They're pointing at each other. The point is, that also doesn't seem like a very good faith effort.
No, you're not
to
doing your
do
job.
The investigation. Yes, Steve.
Max, to buffer your point, let's recall that the same accusations were made about Ray Rice, that the NFL could have indeed got a hold of the video earlier than they did, even though to the fairness of the NFL, they categorically denied there was any truth to that. They didn't know. You remember that supposedly a UPS package was mailed to them? They said they never got it. All remember that whole story
right.
in regards to the Ray Rice video. So the same could be said. So in that regard, there may be a bit of consistency, albeit as unforgivable as it may be, there's a level of consistency with that and Josh Brown. In the end, where the inconsistency comes into play is how Josh Brown has been dealt with so lightheartedly with the backdrop of Ray Rice and Greg Hardy. That's the key here. You have all of this as evidence. You have a recent history to fall back on and how much damage that had done to the NFL shield. And to still allow this to happen for this dude is inexplicable. Makes no sense whatsoever. None.
Yep. And I'm just extremely disappointed with both the Giants and the NFL, and we'd love to hear from them if we're missing any information on this subject. One for Sam Bradford returns to Philadelphia to face his former team where he wasn't feeling the brotherly love from the Eagles, who took Carson Wentz with the second pick in the draft and eventually traded Bradford to the Vikings, leaving Wentz as the Eagles starter. But Bradford's new situation working out just fine, as the Vikings are 5-0, the only undefeated team left in the NFL. Meanwhile, Wentz and the Eagles are 3-2 and third in the NFC East. Max, I want to start with you. Is this a bigger game for Wentz or Bradford?
Such a great question, because there are arguments on both sides, but the answer is it's actually a bigger game for Sam Bradford than Carson Wentz, Stephen A. Smith. It's a bigger game for Sam Bradford, not just because he's going back to Philadelphia, not just because the Eagles' defense, though, while very, very, very good so far this season, is not as good as the Vikings' defense, nor is it perceived that way. People aren't sitting around talking about, oh, my God, where's this Eagles' defense going to rank all time? But people are actually starting to have those conversations about the Vikings. If he loses to this Eagles team, psychologically from that point of view, it's bad for Bradford. But it's more than that. I know you can point to the fact that the Eagles are like scraping and clawing in the NFC East, which should be tight, but now Dallas has put a little wiggle room and they got to keep up and all that. Whereas the Vikings are undefeated. What do they have to worry about, right? But it's even bigger than that, too, because Carson Wentz, we're talking about quarterbacks here, got his whole career ahead of him. And he's the starter in Philly. Ain't nothing going to change that this season. Sam Bradford, this is the year where he can redefine his career. He's not going to have a better chance than he has right now. There's no guarantee, doesn't matter who the head coach is or what kind of personnel they have, that they have a defense that plays this well again. And for Bradford to become, as we've been talking about, Jim Plunkett, right? Can he become the guy who was taken number one overall, injuries and kind of middling success led everyone to say that's a bust as a number one pick? Yeah, he's okay when healthy, but he's nothing special. And then he goes to a place after a pit stop somewhere else, exactly like Bradford. Then he goes to a place where he wins a couple Super Bowls, and all of a sudden you look and you go, yeah, that's a number one overall pick. Bradford is in that moment of a potential renaissance in his career. If he goes to Philadelphia and loses at the place that just got rid of him, there is more, certainly from an emotional point of view, at stake for Bradford.
When you look at the Minnesota Vikings, they've got the worst running attack in football. They're averaging every 70 yards, like 70.6 yards per game, like on 2.5 carries. We know they don't have Adrian Peterson. That's going to put a lot of pressure on Sam Bradford to throw the football. Stephon Diggs having questionable health, over the last several weeks or so. Really, it's one of those situations where Sam Bradford walks into this particular game being 5-0, still not losing much ground in the event that you lose this game, not having all the requisite weapons available to you. He's in a situation where I believe he's playing with house money. That's not necessarily the case with Carson Wentz. Now, obviously, he's a rookie, and clearly he's the future for the Philadelphia Eagles. But I'm talking about in terms of the shine that Carson Wentz was receiving, particularly comparable to that of Dak Prescott. Based on how he's looked over the last couple of weeks, especially last week against Washington, I think this is a bigger game for him. Not just in terms of stature, an elevated level of stature, but in terms of his own personal psyche. Because the last 2 weeks have been relatively rough for him. Not so much in a loss against Detroit, because that was a competitive game. He just threw an interception late in the game, throwing the ball deep. That didn't happen. But last week, they got pushed around by the Redskins. First of all, the Redskins come in their first five games. They had a 100-yard rusher one of those games. Last week, they rushed for 230 yards on the ground against the Philadelphia Eagles. Meanwhile, the Philadelphia Eagles defense couldn't generate anything offensively. They scored because of an interception by Malcolm Jenkins, all right, my frat brother. And then you also got a special team situation where they scored on a punt return. That's how the Eagles scored their touchdowns. Outside of that, they really haven't done anything. And they didn't do anything last week, rather. Meanwhile, Carson Wentz got smacked around, got hit about 11 times, got smacked up. And then you got to look at Minnesota. They've got about three different guys on defense, four linemen, with three or more sacks. You got Everson Griffin, you got Brian Robinson, you got Linval Joseph. That's at least the three. You got five forced fumbles, all right? And so when you look at it from that perspective, they get all up in you. And their secondary is no joke because, again, passes are completing about 55% of their passes. Their quarterback rating is like 65. Everything points to Carson Wentz having a nightmarish day. If he can ward that off, all right, and especially if he's a big reason, if the Eagles win and he's a big reason why, then I think you've got something special potentially. But if he gets ramrodded for a second week in a row and they lose for a third week in a row, I think you're going to see some of that shine dim just a touch with Carson Wentz. And in that regard, I think that's why it's more about him than Sam Bradford. Because with Sam Bradford, again, without Adrian Peterson, with a suspect running game that's the worst in football, with everybody and their mama knowing that you rely on your defense in Minnesota in order to win football games and not turning the ball over. If Sam Bradford doesn't turn the ball over, but he's unable to get things done because of the requisite weapons that are missing from him, that's entirely different than if Carson Wentz goes out there and gets humbled to a point where we find ourselves concerned about a rookie who's being exposed as a rookie, because that's not something we're hearing about Dak Prescott, who's within the same division.
Look, usually these debates are very easy for me because I take the right point of view and just argue away your wrong point of view. But I have to admit, this is a tough call. There's a lot at stake for everyone. You made some good arguments why it's more for Wentz than Bradford, but I could turn those arguments right around on you, Stephen A., which is actually why it's more important for Bradford. You talked about that Vikings defense. Everyone knows that about the Vikings defense. If you fail to beat the Vikings defense, that makes you different from every other quarterback that has played them so far. How? Including Aaron Rodgers. How? Not at all. They destroy quarterbacks. They shut down your offense. That's what they do. So if they do that to Carson Wentz, okay, it's the Vikings. And even then, he's 3-3. Now, you talk about comparisons to Dak Prescott. That's true. That'd be two consecutive weeks where he didn't look so good, and Dak has continued to look good. It's still early in the season, and he is clearly their long-term answer at quarterback. Look at it from Bradford's point of view. This is simple. Matter of fact, this might even drop the mic on you, Stephen A. Smith. We got other things to talk about. Did they get rid of Carson Wentz for Sam Bradford, or did they get rid of Sam Bradford for Carson Wentz?
Well, they did offer Sam Bradford 2 years and $36 million, guaranteeing $22 million, before they realized they would be in a position to move up in the draft.
Right.
Their plan was to start Sam Bradford, but Sam Bradford raised holy hell and wanted out, because his whole thing was, clearly they're drafting Carson Wentz because he's the future. They didn't look at Sam Bradford as the future long term, but they were hopeful he would be the immediate future. When I spoke to Sam Bradford's agent on the phone at the time, he came on my radio show, Sirius XM, Mad Dog Sports Radio, every weekday, 1 to 3 p.m. Eastern time. He came on the show and he said, we were trying to get him out of town. We wanted to get him to Denver. When they originally signed him, we had a two-year plan. It was only a two-year plan, but we were going to use those 2 years to move on to greener pastures because we know that the Eagles, he didn't use the word reclamation project, but that's essentially what he was saying. They thought they had something with Denver, but that fell through. And so when you ask that question, Max, it's actually potentially both. Because what you do is find yourself in a situation where, okay, you got rid of Sam Bradford for Carson Wentz, or whatever other way you want to ask the question. At the end of the day, Carson Wentz is clearly the long-term plan. Sam Bradford was a short-term plan. But Sam Bradford had no interest in being a short-term plan. He wants to be a long-term plan elsewhere. That's what he wanted.
I have two questions
That's
for you.
That's what they were willing to oblige.
I have two questions for you. The first one is rhetorical. When one guy is not there anymore and there's a new guy there, they get rid of one guy for the other guy, who do you think has more at stake, at least psychologically? That's the rhetorical question. The actual question is this, Stephen A. You said I can hear the Stephen A. Smith Show on Sirius Radio between 1 and 3 p.m. weekdays. I just want to make sure I get that straight.
Weekdays, Eastern time.
Eastern time. Got it. On Sirius, Stephen A. Smith, 1 to 3 p.m.
Yeah. Yeah. Every day, every weekday.
No, that's all I needed to know.
All right.
There we go.
We'll leave it there. I'm very excited for this game. Might potentially be the best one of the week. Seattle and Cardinals could be a good one as well. But we had one last night. Aaron Rodgers, your guy, Stephen A., was 39 of 56 for 326 yards and three TDs, leading the Packers to a 26-10 victory over the Bears and setting a franchise record for completions. Rodgers struggled to get the offense moving in the first half, but the offense opened up in the second. Will we see the Aaron Rodgers we used to know this season, Stephen A., that bad man that you love?
I doubt it. And the reason why I doubt it is because I don't have that much confidence in his receivers. He dipped and dunked a lot yesterday, throwing the ball 56 times. Over 20 of them were for 5 yards or less, meaning that's how far he threw the ball. To me, that's not going to get it done. That's not the Aaron Rodgers that I know and love. The Aaron Rodgers that I know and love is whether he's in the pocket or scrambling beyond the pocket. The Aaron Rodgers that I know and love is the Aaron Rodgers that's going to fling the football downfield. I'm not sure that Devontae Adams, even though he had a big game, a Jordy Nelson, a Randall Cobb and those boys are capable of getting open in those situations against some of the better teams. I'm not getting caught up in the Chicago Bears. I think the Chicago Bears are a shell of itself. I think they're contaminated by the mere presence of Jay Cutler, even though he was on the sidelines and not playing. I think that Brian Hoyer going down didn't help matters. Barkley comes in, throws two interceptions. Their offense is anemic. As a result, you can take chances. And as a result, you can take chances on defense. But on the offensive side of the ball, you can afford to be methodical, dip and dunk, and beat them that way, chewing up the clock and just march downfield. And that will be that. Against some of the better teams in the NFL, that's not going to work. I'm not saying that we won't see him. I'm saying that in terms of my confidence level, that bad man that I know him to be, I didn't really see much of that last night. And my attitude is that I'm not going to be convinced until I start seeing him fling that football down the field again. And in order for him to do that, those receivers are going to have. And I'm not confident that that's what they're going to do.
I've been telling everyone to relax about Aaron Rodgers, not because, oh, he's going to go back right away to being what he was before last season, because now this is almost a season and a half, but because this guy is pretty good. I mean, he's better than most. So you still got a good quarterback. You're 4-2. But I also did not see anything new last night. I saw him playing a very bad team. Once Hoyer went down, they had no shot, and they're probably going to lose anyway. The defense really couldn't do much. And I saw him dinking and dunking a lot and really not picking up big chunks of yards. I mean, that was the substitute for the running game, little dink and dunk passes. On the vertical passes, on the stretch vertical, down the field stuff, Same guy, not that accurate. And by the way, where we disagree here is you're blaming his receivers. And certainly he doesn't have Jordy Nelson of a couple years ago. And sure, that would make a difference. However, Casey Joyner, the football scientist, did tape analysis, tape-based analysis, broke down. He sits there and watches all this stuff and records when it's this guy's fault or that guy's fault. Said Rodgers was off target coming into week 7, 37.7% of the time on his vertical passes. Those are aerial thrown down, thrown 11-plus yards down the field. So none of these 5 and 6, and as you said, 5.5 yards a pass, you're throwing it down the field. He's off target, qualifying quarterbacks based on the number of reps they've had. That's tape-based analysis that, according to Casey Joyner, showed, no, not his receiver's fault, not his receivers not being open, Aaron Rodgers not being accurate down the field. So then the question becomes, will we see that bad man again that you love to talk about and I think is when he's right is the best, or was at least till a season and a half ago, the best player in the game? And I'm not convinced we will this season. If you study great athletes in any sport, even the long-time great athletes, there's usually a little dip in their career at some point. They go through that athletic prime early, which is usually the best version of them we see, and then it looks like they're declining, and they're sometimes in their early mid-30s, and then they can have another stretch after that where they're, even if they're a little bit different than they used to be athletically, they're still more or less as good as they ever once were. Maybe a little less, but still approximating it. And usually I think that dip happens when their bodies start to change, they lose a half a step, they're not quite as good as they used to be, they can't get away with quite as much, but they also, because those changes are so imperceptible, they happen so gradually, they haven't yet adjusted to it. And I don't see evidence this season that Aaron Rodgers has adjusted to maybe what the new normal, what the new reality for him is physically. And therefore, I have no reason to believe he will throughout the course of this season. He didn't last year. I don't think he's done as being in the conversation for the best player in the game, but I don't think that's going to happen this year.
Well, listen, I can tell you this. The important reasons as to why that is. And for me, Aaron Rodgers looks distracted. He don't look like himself. He was proud of Devontae Adams last night and the way that he was playing. I remember I was talking to Mark Schlereth on my radio show yesterday, and he was alluding to Aaron Rodgers and how, you know, being distracted. You know, his brother was on The Bachelor. You know, family business got out in public and, you know, all of this other stuff. You know, I mean, just bringing in, you know, some people have been bringing into the equation off-field things that may play a role in how a guy's psyche is and how he approaches the game and how he looks on the field in terms of playing the game of football. I'm seeing Aaron Rodgers underthrow and overthrow. I'm seeing him lose the football. Second consecutive week he's lost fumbles. This is a guy that's made a career not only of throwing beautiful passes, but protecting the football. That doesn't appear to be who he is right now. And it's very shocking to see this happen. And so I look at it from that perspective, and that's one of the things that concerns me about him.
Also, the Jeff Perlman book came out about Favre, and it detailed some of the stuff in his relationship with Aaron Rodgers that was not so flattering for either, maybe particularly not Favre. But at any rate, for those who would dismiss off-the-field distractions as the reason that you could have a negative, or can negatively affect someone's performance, it's really very straightforward. It's common sense. If you have problems at home or in your personal life, does it ever affect your work product? For many of us, the answer is yes. For some, the answer is no. But for many people, the answer is yes. And that goes for athletes, too. And that may be part of the explanation, because what we're seeing the last 6 games this season, or 7 games this season, and all of last season, is not the Aaron Rodgers that once was. It's still a good player, but not the best in the game.
Yeah.
Works for me. Works for me. For now. For now, though. I haven't given up hope.
Yep. No matter how mentally tough you are, at the end of the day, we're all human. And it starts to affect you. Coming up next. The First Take, Your Take, Viewer Contest is here. I cannot wait for this. You can win a chance to debate Stephen A. and Max right here on national television. Who is better than you? All you got to do is go to firsttakeyourtake.com, upload a 1-minute video. So remember, upload the video to that website with your best sports debate. Keep it clean, no music, team logos, trademarks, or copyrighted material. 2 winners will be selected by our show staff. Get to work, people. I want to see you here in Bristol schooling Stephen A. and Max.
The answer as to who is better than you is me. That's the answer. Okay. I win the debate.
Here's the latest submission.
The problem with Aaron Rodgers and the Green Bay Packers is not the bad man himself. It is Coach Mike McCarthy. He's very conservative with his play calling. He has no belief in his players. And that pretty much includes the bad man, Aaron Rodgers.
Basically, look, Rodgers, those guys have all the talent in the world. But what we're finding out is no matter what we want to say about this becoming a passing league, you still have to have a running game to be successful.
Aaron Rodgers, get your head in the game. They're questioning whether you're that guy right now. You don't see the energy. You don't see the passion. You don't see, dare I say, the discount double check.
Yeah, great point. Where's the discount double check? Solid.
Yeah, he missed that one. He missed the discount double check. He missed that one. But it's all right. It's all right.
Solid. Yeah. Solid. And I like the wardrobe. I like the hat.
A lot of flavor. Much more flavor than I thought we'd get. I thought people
would say flavor.
Yep.
I will say to that guy, I will say to that big boy with the bright yellow tie on, blazer, my brother, blazer, complete the outfit. You ain't coming on here without a blazer. I tell you that much.
This man.
Let's roll.
He's a tough critic. All right, coming
He's
up,
right.
The Cubs beat the Dodgers 8-4 last night to get within one of a World Series berth. Since last appearing in the World Series in 1945, the Cubs have lost all six games in which they had the chance to reach the Fall Classic. Max, have you changed your mind about taking the field over the Cubs to win it all?
Nope.
Come on.
I haven't changed my mind, and allow me to troll Stephen A. Smith.
Please.
This explanation will troll you, Stephen A. You won't be able to help it. You're going to be salivating at the mouth like a rabid dog right now. I have not changed my mind.
Why? You're still staying with the field, right?
I'm staying with the field. And yet, I believe the Cubs will close out the Dodgers against Clayton Kershaw.
What?
And at that point.
What?
And at that point.
Oh, my God. Oh, my Lord.
Wait a minute. You've
been talking about the field, and now you won't even take the. Oh, my. Go ahead. Go ahead.
It gets worse.
Go ahead. Oh, my Lord.
Not only am I taking the Cubs to beat Kershaw, at that point, I will switch my prediction and say, no, I like the Cubs to go all the way. And yet at this moment, I am taking the field. How are all these things possible? This is the way probability works. You reset based on new information. I think the Cubs are the favorites in any given series, but that doesn't mean if they fall behind in the series, they remain the favorite, or that just because they're the favorites in two different series, they're the favorites to win the whole thing. A quick math lesson. If you're 60% likely to win a series and 60% likely to win the next one if you win this one, you are only 36% likely to win the whole thing. That's under 50%. That means the field is more likely than you, even though you're favored in both series. Now, I will let you respond to that, Stephen A., because I got a doozy for you with Clayton Kershaw.
I have no response to it because as far as I'm concerned, it makes no sense to me. I'm watching the games. I'm not relying on sabermetrics, analytics, or whomever else is going to throw
you
those numbers out there.
Metrics.
I'm watching. I'm watching Addison Russell. I'm watching Javier Baez. I'm watching this kid, Wilson Contreras, who might end up getting Haywood benched because of the way he's balling in the postseason compared to the way Haywood is balling in this postseason series. That's what I'm looking at. I know what I'm seeing. I came into this series saying I'm rolling with the Cubs and I'm gonna stay with rolling with the Cubs
just
right
the other
now
day you were
because
like,
that's
I
what
have
I'm
to
seeing
admit, just the other day you were like I have to admit I'm getting nervous I'll stay with the Cubs for now but I'm gonna reevaluate.
I did not say I would reevaluate. I said I was nervous, but I'm not changing.
Oh.
I'm going to keep the courage of my convictions because I believe in this young crew. I believe in these Rough Riders and I want that damn curse over and done with so we could stop sitting there and talking about the curse that is the Cubs. I don't want to do that. I got one of my dear friends. His name is Dan Filato. He's from Chicago. He's a radio producer. I've known him for years. He's one of my dear friends. And I'm tired of hearing and seeing them cry about the Chicago Cubs and his best friend Bill Murray crying about the Chicago Cubs. I'm a Yankee fan and I'm almost willing to go to Wrigley Field and sing that song, Take Me Out to the Ball Game, just to bring them luck so they could win. But they don't need it.
That's
they don't
sweet.
Need me to do that, thank God, because they're gonna close this out and they're going to win because this is how it's going down.
You know,
this is the way that they look, no matter how nervous I was.
We're in an election season, of course, and one of the issues that's debated, although it's not always mentioned this way, is Keynesian economics. And John Maynard Keynes.
What?
Yes, that's right. John Maynard Keynes was once accused of flip-flopping because he changed his opinion on something.
Teach me.
And he said, when the facts change, so does my opinion. What about you, sir? Or something to that effect.
Yeah.
So they're down 3-2 the Dodgers now. Yeah, the Cubs are likely to beat them, but they have Clayton Kershaw going. The Dodgers do, right? Here's the problem with Clayton Kershaw. Clayton Kershaw in elimination playoff games in his career, small sample size, nevertheless, he started 4 games. His team is 2-2 in those games. His personal record is 1-2 with a 6.08 ERA. Now, the Cardinals, something's going on with the Cardinals. There have been rumors of, what, are they stealing signs or something? Because they can't believe how well the Cardinals hit Kershaw. Okay, even if you take that out, he's still not quite the same guy in those situations as when there are less pressure-packed situations in the postseason. And others will say, well, that's because they want him to go on short rest. He's not going on short rest this time. Or, hey, look, it's a small sample size. Anything can happen. Blah, blah, blah. For the reason the Dodgers haven't won the whole thing already in these last several years, and they've had a shot a couple times, is because they need Kershaw, at minimum, to be the same version of himself in the regular season. At minimum. What does that mean? That usually Kershaw is a sub-2 ERA. I mean, what that means is Kershaw got to pitch 6 2/3, 7 1/3, minimum 1 run. That would be acceptable. But what about elevating and getting even better under the pressure? Like guys like Curt Schilling, I brought up El Duque, Fernando Valenzuela, and several others who really, John Smoltz and others, who elevated, who actually got, we've seen Bumgarner, get better under pressure. He has to do that. And maybe he does it against the Cubs tonight, but based on his track record, he hasn't inspired confidence in me that he will. What I'm expecting to see is some at least slightly lesser version of Kershaw get closed out by the Cubs tonight. And if and when that happens, I will reevaluate my opinion about the field versus the Chicago Cubs.
So in other words, your position that you're taking the field against the Cubs is something that will change possibly in 24 hours?
Easily, yes. Well, when the field includes 4 teams or 6 teams or 8 teams, it's different than when it includes 1 team, yes.
I have nothing else to say. So far, I've stayed with the Cubs. I'm sticking with the Cubs. I happen to be right. I don't have to debate you
about
this.
We'll see.
You don't even know. Hold it up. You don't even know what the hell you're picking. Everyone knows where I stand. I'm rolling with the Cubs.
I know.
It's just that
I know
simple.
What I'm picking today, but then based on new information, that might change
sure.
tomorrow. It's
sure,
possible.
Sure, sure. Okay, I got it. So you might as well not have picked the series then. That's what you're saying.
Why? No, you're making projections.
Okay. It's Friday, everyone. Let's stay in a good mood.
Okay.
Let's
okay.
leave it there.
I roll with the Cubs. Coming into the series, I'm sticking with the
I'm
Cubs.
I'm always in a good mood when Stephen A. Smith and I are berating each other on TV.
All right, let's leave it there. Coming up, are Tony Romo's days in Dallas numbered? We debate if the Cowboys should consider trading him. Don't miss this. Will Kane in the house berating. You came for that?
That's my call.
Okay, we'll
that's
get the chair call. For you. Berating is his code word. What's up, people?
It's like the bat signal, berating. I come in.
Yeah.
Mediocre team and Big D. That's what makes this funny.
How about the Cowboys? How about the
Cowboys? Some way, somehow, when they count, just wait.
They will let you down.
The accident, they will mess it up. Just wait.
The accident, they will let you down.
Just wait.
The accident.
Tony Romo throw the football, know what's coming next.
He will get in the way.
The deception of success.
Tony Romo throw the football.
Are you kidding me?
That's right, not a catch.
Really?
That's funny.
Big D.
Teasing you.
This is what they do.
Walking through weed show
from on cue.
The accident.
Something will go wrong.
The accident.
Of the big Jumbotron.
Accident.
Wrong. I recognize
it's a black cat running around that franchise.
Stay with
it. Accident.
They will mess it up.
Just wait.
The accident.
Just wait.
The accident,
the accident,
the accident,
waiting to happen.
It won't happen.
How about them Cowboys?
do
you?
I love that. I got to admit it. That's kind of fly.
Oh, yeah. Do you? You love that?
I love it.
I love it.
Shout out to DJ Steve Porter for doing that. Our producer, Stephanie Frenier. That was amazing.
That was great. I'm trying to figure out why the hell is Will Kane sitting on our set.
That was for
Will. Reclined in his chair like he's sitting in a grandfather chair or something. I mean, what's up with that?
I'll tell you why I'm sitting on this set. I mean, everybody knows the answer. I'm sitting on the set because you've got a music video played to your hatred of the Cowboys. And by the way, it's while it's dripping in style. I mean, it almost made it sound like you could rhyme. While it's dripping in style, it's equally devoid of substance. I mean, the line, the punchline, the money line, the accident waiting to happen.
Will Kane, all I can say to you is this. Yes. I've been saying it for years. Well, I know what you're hoping for this year, but I have 20 years of history saying that. Man. So you can say what you want.
Well, I'm going to tell you what I'm going to tell you. That's go like ahead. You saying for years, Will, I've been getting up on this program and telling you the sun's going to come up. And nobody listens to me. Nobody listens to me. But the sun's going to come up in the East. And I've been saying it. And now I got a music video that proves it.
Well, the Cowboys won't
why
come up in the East. The Giants
why
will
you
occasionally.
Because, why you sound jealous? You sound jealous. You sure?
Because,
you all right?
You know, when I got our show meeting notes, I noticed this. I was just going through the show meeting notes, and I noticed this. Ben Roethlisberger out. Torn meniscus. LeSean McCoy, injured hamstring. Eddie Lacy out for the season. Joe Flacco hurt. Terrell Pryor hurt. And I just thought to myself, with all these teams, these poor teams, the Packers, the Bills, the Steelers, accidents waiting to happen, man. Accidents waiting to happen. What's your rebuttal?
You can do the remix.
I got it. Ben Roethlisberger's been to 3 Super Bowls. He's a 2-time Super Bowl champion.
And yet he's hurt.
Tony Romo has 2 playoff victories in his career. What are you talking about? Why are you even mentioning them in the same breath?
Listen to me.
It doesn't matter who's hurt now. I'm talking about historically.
When you predict
throughout their career
that an accident is waiting to happen, literally anything feeds into your argument. You can pull anything. I'm right. And by the way, every year, that prediction is true for 31 teams. 31 teams every year prove you right.
That's your argument. You know better. You better turn to Max and leave me alone before you get your feelings hurt. You know good and damn well 31 teams in the NFL don't have the recent history that the Dallas Cowboys have had. You better stop that nonsense. Yeah. You better stop it.
If they ever do win the Super Bowl, what is his money line going to be? You know this as well as anyone. Even a dead clock is right.
That's right.
Oh, that's the new version. All right.
I wouldn't say that about a Super Bowl championship. That I would not do.
Let's talk a little Tony Romo, gentlemen. Let's get into it. Dak Prescott, he's been balling for the 5-1 Cowboys, and that has left Tony Romo in a very precarious position with the Dallas Cowboys. So many, of course, are wondering, should the Cowboys trade Romo, but which teams would be interested in the quarterback? So USA Today's For the Win ranked the teams that should trade for Romo, and topping the list is the Browns, followed by the Jets, the Bears, the 49ers, the Rams, and the Broncos. Well, I want to let you speak first, out of fairness for the Cowboys here.
Yes.
Should they trade Tony Romo?
No. Molly. They should start.
I like how you said my name. Molly.
They should start Tony Romo. Mm-hmm. That's what they should do, not trade Tony Romo.
Oh, start him. Oh,
start
goodbye.
Tony Romo.
Really? Okay, sorry.
Listen, Tony Romo in 2014 played with this exact same offense, the one that Dak is playing with today. Here's his numbers in 2014. 113 passer rating, 70% completion, 34 touchdown, 9 interceptions. Dak has been amazing. Mm-hmm. Tony would be better. He'd be even better in this offense. He can read defenses, call audibles, adjust the play. He can take the top off of a defense, Stephen A. He can hit Dez down the field in
Freudian
a way.
Slip.
He can hit Dez down the field in a way that Dak cannot right now. Started 2 against the Packers. He gives you upside that Dak does not. Granted, there are a few mistakes, 9 interceptions in 14, along the way that Dak has made very rarely so far. But Dak is a rookie. No rookie has gone to the Super Bowl since Dan Marino. Tony gives you more upside, just as much safety. And if it all goes south, guess what? Dak Prescott's on the bench. Bring him back in. Tony Romo should be the Cowboys' starting quarterback.
Tony Romo should be on the Cowboys' bench. And I was with you on the starting quarterback, but this was the caveat. Look, if the Cowboys are like 5-1 by week 6, and they're in first place and Dak is balling, okay then, which I did not think was going to happen, but that's what happened. And so now, people are confused about this. They have it twisted. It's like, well, you have a quarterback, so you can trade Romo.
Number one, from the Cowboys' point of view, it doesn't make any sense. The problem until now was they didn't have a backup quarterback. Who cares who the backup quarterback is? The fact is, you now have one. And it's a guy who has not shown the ability recently to stay on the field for a whole season. So keep him fresh. Keep him ready to go. He's experienced. He's excellent when healthy. And if you need him for a couple weeks, you got him. Now, he's very, very expensive, but that money is on your books anyway. That's from the Cowboys' point of view. From everyone else's point of view, idiotic for the Browns to trade for Romo. Romo is 36 years old. In 2010, he had a broken collarbone. In 13, he ruptured a disc in his back. In 2014, two fractures in his back. In 2015, he re-broke the collarbone. Later that year, he re-broke the collarbone again, same collarbone. And then in 2016, a fracture in his vertebrae. So he has a back and a collarbone, chronic issues that keep him off the field. Why would the Browns or anyone, the Jets or anyone, trade for a guy unless they're in a season where right now, if we get this guy, we can win the Super Bowl right now? That's not any one of these teams. And if you keep him on your books, you owe him close to $50 million over the next 2 years. And if you get rid of him because he's hurt, you can't game plan with him for a season, you owe him $30 million over the next 2 years. You don't trade him from anyone's point of view. And from the Cowboys' point of view, problem solved. You have a backup quarterback. Who cares what his name is?
If you are the Jets and you believe in your defense, you might. If you are the Los Angeles Rams that's desperate to be relevant and you don't believe in Case Keenum for the next year or two, and you certainly don't believe in leaving Jared Goff yet because you drafted him number one overall and he wasn't even on the active roster in week one, you do it. If you are the Denver Broncos and you're not sold on Trevor Siemian or Paxton Lynch as of yet, but you know that the requisite parts around you could easily repeat as Super Bowl champions because of that defense, because of Emmanuel Sanders and Demaryius Thomas, if you feel those things, then those are three teams right there that should consider making a move for Tony Romo, less with the Broncos because of the dollars, and we understand how reluctant they were because of Brock Osweiler and beyond. But they were talking about trading for Sam Bradford. They couldn't get it done. I'm not saying that you've got the numbers to make it happen. Please don't get me wrong, because I'm conceding that the numbers could be the larger deterrent. But I'm talking about in terms of talent and need, strictly that, without taking the numbers into consideration, because somehow, some way, sometimes at least the numbers could work, sometimes they can't. But strictly as it pertains to talent, strictly as it pertains to situations, I think the Jets, I think the Rams, I think the Broncos could all use and benefit exponentially from the services.
Terrible ideas, all of them. The Jets have 5 losses. They're in a division with the Pats and the Bills. The way the Bills look this year, their season's over. Terrible idea to have that money on the books going forward, and none of the other teams it would make a difference for.
Can I say
the Broncos, this? Maybe this year.
I don't believe that the Jets season is. I believe that the Jets season is over because I assume they're going to continue losing. But if the Jets were to win, say they had a quarterback worth having, I don't think that you could rule out the possibility of a wild card coming out of the AFC East because of the problems in the North, the problems in the South, and the problems out West. Kansas City, to me, with Oakland, could be viable threats in the AFC West. But I think that's primarily, you know, who a wild card spot in the AFC East would be competing with.
You don't have to leave that as an abstraction, you know. If the Jets had a quarterback, they could compete. You're basically admitting the thing you don't want to admit, which is Tony Romo turns you into somebody who makes the playoffs, makes you a team worth competing. The name you're leaving out is Tony Romo.
I'm willing to admit that, Will. See, that's why you don't pay attention.
You
got
attention.
Your ears clogged and you don't listen. I absolutely believe that Tony Romo is capable of it. I happen to believe that the playing for the Dallas Cowboys is tantamount to having a black cat running around your house. Bad luck is coming your way. I never once said that Tony Romo couldn't play. I never once said that he didn't make big plays. I never once said that he couldn't be a game changer. I'm saying it never has happened when it's really, really counted for the Dallas Cowboys. That is what I have said.
Tony Romo was on the trading blocks. Half the league would be interested in him. Who would make sense for is a different equation. And I agree with Stephen A., by the way. The Rams and the Broncos are at the top of the list because they could theoretically compete this year with a quarterback the caliber of Tony Romo. But once again, the Dallas Cowboys, both financially, as you point out, Max, and just quality quarterback-wise, have no interest in trading Tony Romo. Now, granted, and I'm so objective, I see my lack of objectivity. I'm a fan.
And modest.
I'm a fan, and I want a magical ending. And I want to see this work for Tony Romo for another season and a half, and then it be Dak's job. And that's when it lines up financially, by the way, as well. 2018, after the 17 season, is when it financially begins
to make sense
for them to separate.
You're skipping something very conveniently. And I think this is because you're wish casting, as most fans do, if everything worked out perfectly. What about the fact that the guy has chronic injuries? They keep happening to his back, which is debilitating.
And you have
to his collarbone. Right, but what I'm saying is on the trade block, everyone's aware that this 36-year-old quarterback, to whom a great deal of money is owed going forward, guaranteed, has these injuries, and they're chronic. And why would they make that move right now?
I'll leave it here. It depresses his value. It does not negate his value.
And one other thing you need to keep in mind, if they do switch to Tony Romo and go back, you need to know how the locker room feels, because you don't want to disrupt the locker room.
Guy's been there a decade.
And that chemistry.
Guy's been there a decade.
And I would just want to know how the locker room feels and what they think.
Usual, Molly's right.
We want you guys to weigh in on Twitter. Should the Cowboys trade Tony Romo? We'll share those results a little later in the show. Well, thank you so much for being with us.
Thank
Since
you,
guys. You liked this song so much, we want to play it again for you one more time.
Oh, awesome.
Before
great
you
song.
Exit.
Thank you.
Mediocre team and Big D. That's what makes this funny.
How about the Cowboys? How about the
Cowboys? Some way, somehow, when they count, just wait.
They will let you down.
The accident, they will mess it up. Just wait.
The accident, they will let you down.
Just wait.
The accident, wait. The accident, wait. The accident,
waiting to happen. It will happen.
Tony Romo throw the football. You know what's coming next.
He will get in the way.
Deception or success.
Tony Romo throw the football.
Now you kidding me?
That's prime, not a catch.
Really?
That's funny.
Big D.
Teasing you.
This is what they do.
Walk it.
Do we show up on cue?
Accident.
Something will go wrong.
Accident.
Of the big jumbotron.
Accident.
Don't I recognize
it's a black cat running around that franchise.
Stay with it.
Accident.
They will mess it up. Just wait.
The accident.
They will let you down.
Just wait.
The accident.
Wait. The accident.
Wait.
In the AFC game of the week, the 5-1 Patriots travel to Pittsburgh to face the 4-2 Steelers. It's a matchup of division leaders, but the game has lost some of its luster because, of course, Big Ben's knee injury. At the beginning of the season, these two teams were the favorites to win the conference. Mark Schlereth now with us. Always good to see you.
It's great to see you. Great to be here once again.
How we doing?
You good? Excellent. Yeah. Definitely doing well. Thank you.
Good. Is this game a preview of the AFC Championship game?
Well, interestingly enough, I mean, how long is Ben Roethlisberger going to be hurt? Can you tell me that first? If it's 2-3 games, then I think it could be. I think the thing about the Pittsburgh Steelers, offensively, they're as dynamic as any team in the National Football League. Maybe the most dynamic team in the league when it comes to just being able to put up offensive numbers with the weapons that they have with Ben Roethlisberger at the helm. Now, you've seen this, two losses for the Pittsburgh Steelers. Both of those losses indicate to me that when they don't click on the offensive side of the ball, when they're not putting up numbers and they're not putting up big-time scoring opportunities, their defense can't run and can't hang with anybody. When I look at the Pittsburgh Steelers defensively, I don't see one guy on that roster that makes me shake in my boots as an offensive coordinator, an offensive coach, going, how are we going to block that guy? How are we going to contend with that guy? You know, there's no Troy Polamalu. There is no James Harrison when James Harrison was young and a pass-rushing phenom. Hayward is a good player. Shazier is the most dynamic athlete they have on their defense, but Shazier can never stay healthy enough to stay on the field. So there's not one guy that you go, oh, my goodness, how are we going to contend with that guy? If we need to go spread five wides and just five one-on-ones up front, that doesn't scare us as an offense when we play the Pittsburgh Steelers. That's what's going to cost them a chance. Not so much this Roethlisberger injury. Their defense is what will cost them a chance to play in the AFC Championship game.
So, I mean,
their defense.
Guys,
go ahead, Max.
Go.
Their defense is horrible as far as I'm concerned. I have no faith in their secondary. I get that. But I think that when you have a potent enough offense, particularly one that's experienced at moving the chains, I think that that can change a lot of things. Going into this Sunday's game, do I believe they're going to win? Hell no. I have no faith in Landry Jones. But I will tell you this. I do have faith that the Steelers could still get to an AFC championship game against the New England Patriots, not just because of the requisite weapons that they have around them, but because, as Max likes to say, when Mike Tomlin got the Steelers job, what are the Steelers all about? Run the ball, stop the run. Okay? Well, run the ball. Le'Veon Bell shouldn't have 10 carries. Le'Veon Bell should be given the ball. And I think that I know why, what's happening right now. I think the complaints about physicality that the team has had to endure during working out, whether it's training camp, in-season practices during the week, whatever the case may be, Ben Roethlisberger speaking, I think that the Steelers got the message. I think what's happening right now, I suspect, I do not know, but I suspect what is happening now is that Mike Tomlin and Todd Haley and those boys are sitting there and thinking about conservation. They're thinking about making sure they don't run guys into the ground, that they're not running them all over the place, so that they will be fresher as the season wanes. This is what I suspect is happening. And if they're somehow able to pull it off where they remain competitive, where they remain in the running for the AFC North, I think what you're going to see is them gearing themselves towards this team, particularly its running back duo of the 33-year-old D'Angelo Williams, along with the Le'Veon Bell, making sure that their legs are fresh to run the football more as the season wanes, which is why I'm confident that they could still get to that AFC championship game, because whereas it may not be good enough to beat the Patriots this weekend, it will be good enough to beat most of the teams in the AFC when it's time.
I never thought the Steelers were going to make the AFC championship game this year. I still think it's the Broncos and the Patriots, but I know why people think it's the Steelers, because you look at potentially what it could be, as you said, Mark, as long as they make the playoffs, and then they get Roethlisberger and Tomlinson, I said, reminds me of him, and
Le'Veon Bell.
Le'Veon Bell, and obviously Antonio Brown, and show me a team with three better weapons all on the same team. It's ridiculous how good they could potentially be. But I think that's the problem with people analyzing the Steelers. We all kind of dream about what might be if they're firing on all cylinders. But, and you can speak to this much better than anyone here, obviously, so much has to go right to win a Super Bowl or to make it to a championship game, because so much is going to go wrong on every team.
Right.
But it seems to me like more has gone wrong for the Steelers in terms of health, suspensions, et cetera, in recent years, last couple of years, than it has for other teams. And I don't have confidence going forward the rest of this season that more is going to go right for them than is going to go right for the Broncos or Patriots.
I would say this about the Steelers right now. What is in their benefit is they play in the AFC North. Right now, Flacco hasn't practiced the last 2 days because of his shoulder issues. Cincinnati was one of the best red zone teams in football last year. They're one of the worst, not only offensively, but defensively this year. They have issues. Cleveland plays in that division. So regardless of who's starting at quarterback, you're going to win those two games when you face the Cleveland Browns. So I would look at it from this standpoint. This is a race to 10. Whichever team can get to 10 first wins this division. If you win this division, you're going to have yourself in the driver's seat to potentially, in my mind, compete for the AFC championship crown. Now, it's not going to go through Pittsburgh, but at least Pittsburgh will more likely than not get a home game in that scenario.
A lot of people are off the Broncos now, not just because Simeon, look, he's not such a great quarterback yet, but I think Elway has demonstrated in the last couple of years he could put a team together maybe without a great quarterback and still do some business. He could put a defensive team together, an offensive team together. And people, I think, are a little off the Broncos now also because they lost a couple of games in a row, but they played the two best offenses in the NFL. They really didn't give up that many points, and one of those games was on the road. I still feel like people are off the Broncos too fast. Everyone's on the Pats, but I feel like they're off the Broncos a little too fast.
Yeah, no, I would agree.
Well,
they might be off
the Broncos a little bit too fast, but that's because of suspect belief in Trevor Siemian or Paxton Lynch, because we all know how important the quarterback position is. C.J. Anderson could play. Demaryius Thomas and Emmanuel Sanders can play. The offensive line has been upgraded to some degree. We know what the defense can do despite the loss of Danny Trevathan and Malik Jackson. But in the end, what it comes down to is, do you believe in your quarterback? Not just his ability, but his decision-making. And because they leave you suspect in that regard, that doesn't help. And then, particularly in the loss with Atlanta, we saw their linebackers having difficulty covering, and we saw them having difficulty defending the run. We didn't anticipate that from Denver. We've been so busy praising their secondary with Tlaib and Harris Jr. and Roby and those boys, recognizing how elite they were, arguably the best in football, that we forgot about that front seven, how it's been compromised, and how teams believe not only can we beat Denver by running the football, but also by getting them and, you know, using runners out of the backfield, using tight ends,
isolating their
forcing
linebackers
coverage, to defend the pass. That's where it really you're dealing with here, and that's your problem. And so when you can't do that, and you got problems on offense in terms of moving the chains, it's going to be problematic for you.
Yeah, complementary football becomes big for the Denver Broncos. Their offensive line has been abysmal the last 2 weeks. They have been horrible.
Yes.
They had a pretty good start in the first 2 weeks of the season. They have been really poor since that time. They haven't run the ball, so they haven't taken pressure off of their young quarterbacks. One thing's for sure, on a Thursday night, they played an injured Trevor Siemian. It goes to show you that they don't believe that Paxton Lynch is ready to lead a football team right now. Doesn't mean that he can't in the future, but it just means that right now he's not ready to play. I said they were thin going into the season at the quarterback position. That's going to be an issue for them going forward, but they have got to be better when it comes to complementary football. They have got to produce on offense to take at least some of that pressure off the defense, who has spent entirely too much time the last couple of weeks defending high-potent offenses.
No question. As far as Patriots, Steelers, so disappointed we're not going to see these two at full strength. So I was so excited to see this game when Tom Brady returns. And I just want to say thank you to you for making time for us. Because besides NFL Live and your radio show, now I've seen you on Ballers. And then yesterday, yeah. What's the commercial that I saw? It was another national commercial with you in a white tee.
Well, you know, America is begging me to become an underpants model.
Yep.
So I just did it for Hanes.
Yeah, I saw it. This little old Hanes, you and MJ.
Yeah, that's right.
Good looking sucker over here.
I can't wait till MJ and I. Here on First Take.
MJ and I are doing commercials together. It's only a matter of time.
It's a tough life. Somebody has to live it. The Schlereth. Thank you. Good to see you. Have a great
weekend.
Remember when Tiger Woods was great? Good times. He still thinks he can return to form to Jack Nicklaus's major record. Can he do that? We'll discuss it next.
Jack has always been one of my heroes. You know, I looked up to him. I looked at his
have
record.
Have you lusted for his record?
I wouldn't say lusted for his record,
but
I just think that was the gold standard, because, you know, he had won the most majors and the second most tour events. And here he is
at 18. And you're at
14? I'm 14, correct.
And you believe you'll have more than 18?
Correct.
And if you don't, you will say?
I didn't get there.
Tiger Woods, he's still confident he will catch Jack Nicklaus's 18 majors, but he's been stuck on 14 major championships since winning the U.S. Open in 2008. Woods hasn't played in a tournament in more than 14 months after having two back procedures, and he pulled out of last week's Safeway Open after saying his game was vulnerable and not where it needs to be. Stephen A., will Tiger ever win another major?
No. I think it's over. I don't believe it, but I want to emphasize that I will never be more happy to be wrong than if Tiger Woods comes back and he wins a major. I want him to win five. I want him to surpass Jack Nicklaus' record of 18 all time. I don't even think he'll get to 15. I think it's over for him. I think he's psychologically warped. I think he's physically damaged. And I just think that age, attrition, both mentally and physically have kicked in, and that he'll never be what he was. You could still win a major by never being what you were if others plummeted. But the Rory McIlroys of the year, of the day and others, I don't see that happening. The Jason Days of the world and others, Phil Mickelson, even though the age-old veteran, I don't see all of them collapsing and Tiger Woods being able to take advantage of it. I just think that he's psychologically warped. I don't think it's just as much about the physical as everybody wants to make it out to be. Certainly training to be a Navy SEALs and, you know, being in peak physical condition and working himself to death physically may have factored into the equation. That's why he's got the back surgeries, had the knee issues, and beyond. We get all of that. Do I think he can physically overcome stuff? Yes. I think emotionally, mentally, the psychological damage he did to himself by allowing himself to be exposed as the phony he came across as being is something he'll never recover from. Because when you spend your life, your adult life, living a lie because you wanted to project yourself as being somebody that you weren't for the services of other people, and ultimately you get exposed, you walk around forever devoid of that oomph, that it factor that you walked around doing. Max, I'll take it to a certain level here. In this business, there are people who care. When you're in a hot seat, they care about stuff. And I'm not speaking negatively or positively about anybody. I'm just saying that there are people who go through that. They just care. And then there are those like me who do not. When I aspire to be a general sports columnist, to opine and editorialize and give my opinion, I literally was raised in this business watching the Sam Donaldsons of the world to the Ted Koppels of the world, and the list goes on and on, and then the Brian Gumbels and the Howard Cosells of the world and people like that. You trained for this. Tiger Woods walked around with that naturally. He did not give 2 cents about what he was thought of when it came to competing. He only cared about his image off the playing field. And then when that was exposed and it was compromised, everything fell apart. I don't think he recovers from that.
First,
I just don't.
He's not going to tie or break Nicklaus's record of 18. And by the way, at some point it has to be said that back when he was in his prime, or people thought maybe not even in his prime yet, there was the assumption, I think, by the majority that he was going to be the greatest who ever lived. But more conservative observers of golf, who know a lot more about golf than me, were saying, pump the brakes a little bit. And people were like, oh, come on, Tiger's going to be the best ever. And it turns out that they were right, that he will not catch Nicklaus. Nicklaus is, in fact, the greatest golfer of all time. And Tiger will go down in history as the second greatest golfer so far of all time. I think, like, that needs to be said. But will he win? And by the way, here's an irony of the situation Tiger Woods finds himself in. He's going to be a victim of the Tiger Woods effect, because today, although golf is the least athletic sport, if you consider it a sport and not a game, it is sporting, certainly. Of all the kind of sports that people pay attention to, golf requires the least athleticism. But because of Tiger Woods and the way he popularized the game and how famously he was in such great shape for a golfer, a lot of athletes put golf clubs in their kids' hands at a young age instead of footballs or baseballs or basketballs. Nope. Here's a golf club. And so now those kids have come of age, and you have McIlroy and Spieth and better athletes now at younger ages playing golf. And now Tiger has to compete against them. And I think he largely created that climate.
I have a question for you. Yep. I need you to answer this for me. Jordan, you know, Spieth and McIlroy and those boys, I get that point. But here's what I want you to answer for me. I believe Tiger Woods is image conscious. I think that when you want mass appeal, particularly in this country and globally, you know, a vast majority of American citizens are white. There are folks everywhere, obviously, who are white. To make big money, the kind of money that Tiger Woods has made throughout his career, there's a level of acceptance, of the ability to ingratiate yourself with that audience that you have to capture. I think Tiger had it. I think as a result, it made him even more image conscious. And when everything fell apart, I believe he walks around not even comfortable in his own skin, and I believe it has compromised his game.
I agree with that.
See that? You say what?
I agree with that, and I think he needs to get back to being whoever he, or get to being whoever he is. If that's modest, if that's a braggart, if that's a freak, if that's a straight down the line guy, he has to be that guy, and then he'll get back to the best version of himself. I just want to quickly say, I do think he will win another major before he's done. At least one more. Because Nicklaus was in his mid-40s when he came from behind, shot a 30 on the back nine to come from behind to win the Masters. The point is, in golf, one good day and you can beat the field. And I think Tiger has at least some good days left in him.
One. Mentally. They didn't have those problems. He has.
We shall see. We got to leave it there, gentlemen. More First Take after the break. Stay with us, won't you? Big game in the desert this Sunday night when the 3-3 Cardinals host the 4-1 Seahawks. Is this game a must-win for the Cards? Max Kellerman.
Of course. And this is, and I don't think they will win it. And this is why a lot of people, including our very own Molly.
I know.
But like many people did like the Cardinals at various points in the offseason.
I picked them to go to the Super Bowl.
A lot of people, they may have even been the overall favorite to win the Super Bowl this year, according to many lights. I just didn't like what I saw from Carson Palmer in the playoffs last year. And I just prefer Seattle to Arizona in that division and just period. If you look at it's absolutely a must win for Arizona. I just don't think they're less than the sum of their parts. And Russell Wilson has become a kind of next level Hall of Fame caliber quarterback, from just a really good quarterback to a really great one. You look at what the Seahawks have done against Arizona. They've won three straight road games against them. But Stephen A., they've scored at least 34 points in each game, each road game of the last three against them. And have beaten or have outscored the Cardinals, right, have beaten them by an average of 23.7 points a game. Not only do I think it's a must-win for the Cardinals, but Seattle's going to win. I don't think it'll be particularly close.
I disagree. I'm going to pick Arizona to win this game. I do find it to be a must-win situation for them. At the beginning of the season, I thought these teams would split in their two meetings just like they split last year. Carson Palmer played lights out in a win, played very anemic in a loss. Both teams start out strong in their, you know, against one another, and that's why they won their respective games that they won against each other last year. I think this is one of those situations. I'm watching the Tyrann Mathieu matchup against Jimmy Graham, because Jimmy Graham seems to finally be living up to expectation. I think the Cardinals' defense is good enough to apply some pressure. There's always the Patrick Peterson factor against going up against Richard Sherman. Richard Sherman against Fitzgerald is going to be good, but Michael Floyd has to step up and get some things done. I just think Johnson at the running back spot can do some things, because I think he's a playmaker out of the backfield as a dual threat. We talked about Le'Veon Bell, but he may be second in terms of being a dual threat out of the backfield. Of course, everything comes down to Carson Palmer, and none of us, neither one of us, have a lot of confidence in Carson Palmer in the grand scheme of things at the end of the day. But from a regular season perspective, do I believe he's more than capable of stepping up in a regular season game, particularly one so pivotal, where if you lose this game, Seattle's going to have a full two-game lead ahead of you in the win column? I think that Carson Palmer is more than capable of stepping up. I think Derek Johnson is capable of helping. I think Bruce Arians could be innovative enough on the offensive side of the ball. And I think defensively, they have the capability to neutralize Seattle offensively. I'm going to pick the Arizona Cardinals to win a tight game here.
Everyone was predicting he was going to have this breakout season, and then early on he is a beast. I mean, the guy is a monster, no doubt about it. But as I've been saying, Seattle is actually the New England of the NFC. They are different from everybody else in that division. Pete Carroll's and Russell Wilson's Seattle Seahawks are the Patriots of the NFC. Every single year, they're going to be in the playoff mix. They're going to get to the divisional round. Like, at least they're going to advance in the playoffs. And these are the kind of games where I think they separate themselves, where it is the Cardinals' year, it's not the Cardinals' year. Maybe they'll win 8 or 9 or 10 games. Maybe they won't. But you know who's going to be good every year and rack up these kind of wins every year and be in the mix for the Super Bowl every year out of the NFC? The Seahawks, and I like them tonight.
We ain't talking about every year. We're talking about this Sunday.
Yeah, I think that's why they win these games.
It's going to be the game of the week. Prime time, baby. Can't wait. Coming up, we asked you guys to weigh in on Twitter. Should the Cowboys trade Mr. Romo? We'll reveal those results after the break and see more of your take clips. My highlight of the show. Back in a few. You know what it is. It's the First Take Your Take viewer contest, and you could win a chance to debate Stephen A. and Max right here on national television in my home state of lovely Connecticut. All you have to do is go to firsttakeyourtake.com, then upload a one-minute video with your best original sports debate. Keep it clean, no music, team logos, trademarks, copyright material. Two winners will be selected by our show staff. Come to ESPN headquarters and school Max and Stephen A., and I can't wait for all of it. Here's a few of our latest submissions.
What happened against Miami? 1-4 team beats the Pittsburgh Steelers, a team that has the best wide receiver, lost to a 1-4 team?
Stephen A., I'm sorry, but on the aspirations of the Steelers winning the Super Bowl, they're done. They are an accident waiting to happen. When the Steelers, they start getting everything moving, they start rolling good, what happens? Big Ben gets injured.
The Steelers will be fine. There's no need to panic. You have Landry Jones. This is what you drafted him for. He's not the franchise quarterback. He's serviceable. As long as the coaches simplify the game plan, Landry Jones will be fine by the time Big Ben comes back.
Oh.
All right. Hold on.
He hit you in the face.
Hold on. That last brother right there, what the hell he think he doing trying to look like Odell Beckham Jr.? All right, the hairdo. That ain't working. That ain't working.
No one was paying attention to that. They all heard the Steelers are an accident
waiting to happen.
I'm not worried about that. What number two, where are the ladies? I saw no ladies in any of those videos from today. Where are the ladies?
Ladies, we want to hear from you. Way to gloss over the Steelers thing. Real quick.
He's been sending in some good videos.
Yes, we need more of them. We asked you guys to should the Cowboys trade Romo 68%.